everyone have a seat? I think there are a few here and scattered hither and yon. My name is Nancy Spanis, and I'd like to invite you to be welcome here at the kickoff of a series of conferences internationally by the Schiller Institute on the theme of Development is the New Name for Peace. And with the conference will be comprised of three sessions. This morning, we are going to deal with the question of the recovery from the impending collapse, keynoted by Lyndon LaRouche. This afternoon, further on the program for global reconstruction, and this evening, why we need a cultural renaissance, but that I understand that will heavily involve the programs of the Oasis Plan and the Silk Road land bridge, Eurasian land bridge, which are key arteries for reversing the kind of devolution we're seeing in the world economy today. So without further ado, I want to introduce to you Lyndon LaRouche on the recovery from the impending collapse.
Thank you very much, distinguished guests, friends. I just want to, as a matter of note, that during the opening portion of remarks, I will refer to a map which is copied on page 7 of this pamphlet, which I understand most of you have, and if you don't have it, maybe if you wave an arm or something, or somebody will get one to you. Okay, I'll refer to that during my opening remarks with some extensively before I get into the program as such.
This is backwards.
That's all right. I don't really have to see it. As long as they do what I think they're supposed to be doing.
That's the education pamphlet.
Creativity. Yeah. Well, you may have noticed that the United States recently had a midterm election, which was, from the standpoint of anyone knowing what's going on behind the scenes, is really inconclusive. What we've seen surfacing in the United States behind people like Senator Phil Gramm and others is a revival of something which we last saw conspicuously in Europe, notably in Germany, during the 1920s and 1930s. There is a rather famous book written by a veteran of that period, a Dr. Armin Mohler, a Swiss former volunteer for the Waffen-SS, who is resident in München and who wrote a book bragging about his trying to disassociate himself from Hitler, but bragging about what he was a part of, the thing that Mr. Newt Gingrich is proud to be a part of today. It was called the Conservative Revolution. One part of the Conservative Revolution were, of course, the Nazis in Germany. But the Nazis were only one of about 100 organizations in Europe which all belonged in that period to the category of conservative revolution, which is a much more accurate term than the generic and loosely used term fascist. At the end of the war, one branch of the conservative revolution was organized under the sponsorship of Winston Churchill in Switzerland. That organization was called the Mont Pelerin Society. And its leader, until 1992 when he died, was a fascist by the name of Friedrich von Hayek, who is the man who confused the word fascism with freedom and free trade with prosperity. The notable feature of the appearance of the conservative revolution, which has been around, fascism has been around in the United States as an endemic problem for a long time. Milton Friedman is an example of a fascist in the strictest sense of conservative revolution. But the thing that brought the fascist vote out, not implying that all Republicans are fascists by any means, but brought the fascist vote out, was the fact that the United States, like most of the world, is going through an experience which is comparable to that which Germany went through during the 1920s. Unlike Germany of the 1920s, we have not really lost any wars recently. We may have fought a few we shouldn't have fought, but we didn't lose any conspicuously. We're not under occupation of anybody but the British and the United Nations Organization. But we are economically, culturally, and socially a growing percentile of our people in the United States are demoralized and enraged for reasons quite similar to the spread of demoralization and rage in Central Europe and also in France during the 1920s and 1930s. So we have, under these circumstances, what I believe you will see is the temporary eruption of a leading fascist organization headed by Newt Gingrich, called the Squeaker of the House, I believe, which typifies the fact that we're in a crisis. What has happened is that the way in which government has become habituated to doing things, and not only government, over the recent period no longer works. Government generally, in Europe and North America and elsewhere, is a failure. The collapse of the Soviet and Warsaw Pact system in 1989 to 1991 was simply a reflection on the communist side of what is a worldwide breakdown of the kinds of systems which were built up during the post-war period, but especially a breakdown of the new institutions which began to emerge between 1964 and 1968 in the United States, Western Europe, and elsewhere. The prevailing axiom of politics all consistently fail. The politicians say, well, if we have to perfect our policy to be consistent with our axioms. If free trade fails, we've got to have a stronger dose of free trade, even if it kills us. And thus, that's the way things are. The policies which people think are the cures or the remedies for our affliction are in fact the policies which under these circumstances are ruining us. It's like the fellow who insisted on taking a certain road to work every day, even after the bridge had blown out. What we've come to, as I shall briefly indicate before getting into the development outline, is an indication of what the nature of this crisis is which grips the entire planet, but most notably those sections of the planet which are deemed the dominant or most powerful sections, including the United States. One might say that the problem of the U.S. political process is that the think tanks and politicians, with a few exceptions, have not got a clue as to what's going on. And everything they do, because of their ignorance and because of their misguided beliefs, will turn out to be a terrible mistake. And the voters who are very angry, they did not really vote for Mr. Gingrich and his type. They voted against anybody who was in office. As rage, as frustration, hopelessness. Now, what is actually happening, and this may seem a bit complicated at first, but I hope I can make it clear to you. What we are in the middle of is the end of an entire dynastic cycle in modern Western European civilization, which of course has become, because of its power, a worldwide civilization. Every part of the world is assimilated in some degree or another into Western European civilization as it emerged over the period from about 1440 AD to about 1600 AD. It is that civilization, that dominant civilization, which is in the process of collapsing. We might say in the olden times, in medieval and ancient times, one spoke, especially in Asia, of dynastic cycles, We remember the dynasties of China, the dynasties of the subcontinent of Asia, the dynasties of Mesopotamia, the dynasties of Canaan, the dynasties of Egypt, the dynasty of Rome, which is the Asiatic model, again. We study, of course, the rise and fall, or the rise and decline, of these dynastic cycles. We are now coming to the close of a dynastic cycle which, in point of fact, is about 500 or more years old. The cycle began with the collapse of the previous form of society in Europe, a collapse which occurred officially about 1350 AD, when the existing financial and banking system of Europe, which was involved in a large debt bubble, somewhat similar to the worldwide derivatives speculative bubble today, blew out. When the King of England discovered that he was guilty of seducing his creditors into the mortal sin of usury by continuing to pay usurious loans, he decided to try to help save his creditors' souls by repudiating the sinful debt. That resulted in a collapse of the two leading banking houses of Europe at the time, the Bardi and the Peruzzi, and immediately the entire banking system of Europe collapsed. As a matter of fact, it disintegrated. We are now facing something similar. The disintegration of our civilization became obvious from about 1964, 1968. Those of you who have studied the experience of developing nations, and some have come from there, and so they know something about it, recognize that in the middle of the 1950s, until the assassination of John F. Kennedy in the United States, at least the lip service policy of the United Nations and of the leading nations of the world was a policy which was that of President Franklin Roosevelt during the Second World War. The policy of Roosevelt was that what we call today the developing nations should be freed from slavery to British and other forms of imperialism and colonialism, and that these nations had the right to develop. They had the right to access to the technology by which they could meet their own needs and take equal standing in the community of sovereign nation states. Churchill violently opposed the policy, and much to Churchill's gratification, Roosevelt died in 1945, and a man who was more tractable to the ideas of London, Harry Truman, took office. But despite the fact that Truman betrayed, in effect, the policies of his predecessor, Mr. Roosevelt, and capitulated to Truman, to Churchill, nonetheless, as a veteran of that period, coming back from India and Burma in the end of that war, I can attest to the fact that most of we returning veterans, particularly who had seen something of Asia as well as Europe, but particularly Asia, recognized in the condition and the oppression of the peoples of Asia that if we did not cure this problem and bring economic and related justice to the peoples of these oppressed areas, that we were leaving one war to bury, to plant the seeds of another. And it was the general mood of we among the returning veterans who came to political power and leadership in the United States at about the time that Kennedy became president. And we were for this, just as we were generally supported the ideas that Kennedy is associated with, whether or not we agreed with him on his marital behavior or whatever else. The man represented a generation of which we were a part. The civil rights legislation in the United States was not merely a product of the civil rights movement, as led by great people, including a genius by the name of Martin Luther King, but the success of the civil rights movement was not due to the struggles of the African American. But the fact, because the African Americans had been struggling for freedom in the United States for more than two centuries before then. The reason was that the African American, under good leadership, found in the returning veteran from World War II, then coming to power in the United States, a responsive audience which was sympathetic to that cause. And so during that period of the 1950s and the early 1960s, it was considered only just that people of the developing country should have a right to access to technology and the other trappings of national sovereignty, to attain their dignity and to build a community on this planet of sovereign nation states, which would be the condition, precondition for peace. And this was reflected in the United Nations Organization's first development decade. The last gasp of that development decade policy appeared in the middle of the 1960s, when U Thant, then the UN General Secretary, issued a second development decade proposal, which was the last time that anybody in the UN, in the officialdom, or anybody in the metropolitan countries in terms of governance, seriously proposed that the developed countries, the industrialized countries of the planet, should make it a mission to bring the underdeveloped countries of this planet into full access to the technologies, to the science, to the development, which would make them independent nations standing on parity with the other nations of this planet. During the period 1964-68, the period of the Vietnam War's anti-war movement, and such things, a change occurred. This civilization, whose power rested upon institutions established during the Renaissance in about 1440, had introduced two, and you'll refer in this point to this chart, I'll get to it in a moment, why I referred it to you, had built three kinds of new institutions which transformed this planet. One was the idea of the sovereign nation state under law, not a nation ruled as a tribe, not a nation ruled by a ruling family, not a groups of peoples who were under the domination of some ruling group, but that the people, the families, the population of a nation should constitute themselves collectively as a nation state under law, according to principles of law, and according to a common form of literate language. Because if you don't have a literate language, you cannot communicate important ideas. And if you cannot communicate important ideas in a common language, you cannot deliberate important matters. And if you cannot deliberate important matters, you cannot rule yourself. You cannot participate efficiently in government. You can vote for this or that, but you cannot deliberate the policies efficiently upon which the life or death of the nation may depend. The second thing, in addition to the nation-state form, which was the establishment of modern science. Now, modern science actually began, even though it has roots way back, including Plato and the Academy of Athens over the 200 years approximately, from 400 B.C. to 200 B.C. Nonetheless, science in a general way was established by an article or a book written by one of the founders of the Council of Florence, Nicholas of Cusa, called De Docta Ignorantia, or Learned Ignorance. And this book established the principles of method of modern science. And Cusa and the others who established modern science also established the commitment of the nation state to the betterment of the condition of mankind through the fostering and realization of scientific and technological progress in order to uplift the condition of mankind as an individual and in families. And it was on that basis that this curve that you see in the chart was realized. Prior to 1440 AD, on this planet, through the 2 million years or so previously that mankind is known to have existed on this planet, the human race never exceeded a population of about several hundred million persons at the maximum. That is, the potential population density of this planet was limited both by natural conditions and by the inability of the human species to make enough progress to break that barrier of several hundred million. Much worse, the condition of mankind until the European Renaissance throughout this planet was mostly bestial. 95% or more of the population of all parts of this planet lived in serfdom, slavery, or brutish toil of that similar form. Illiterate, barely surviving, subject to all kinds of cruelties and penalties and abuses. And the entire development of mankind out of that condition of virtual bestialization for most of the population, apart from the few that got celebrated, was the result of the benefits of the institution of nation state, the institution of science and cultural development of a similar type, and the institution of technological and scientific progress generally, applied both to increase the productive powers of labor, to change the conditions of community and family life for the better, and a commitment to, by society to attempt to address its material problems of life by means of finding the technologies to assist man in gaining the power to overcome disease, to overcome hunger, to increase the potential population density of this planet. In point of fact, if we fully deployed the level of scientific knowledge which we have achieved at about 1968-69, we could sustain quite comfortably upon this planet 25 billion people with a standard of life approaching or reaching that which was enjoyed by the standard so-called typical American back in those years. We have the means. That's not the limit. There is no limit to what we can do in scientific progress if we put our mind to it. But what happened then was in 1964-68, there occurred what was called a cultural paradigm shift. This radiated from the British monarchy, this cultural paradigm shift, to an institution which is called today the World Wildlife Fund, or the Worldwide Fund for Nature, headed by Prince Philip. This organization is backed and is an instrument of the most powerful oligarchical assembly on the world, in the world today, which is called commonly the Club of the Isles. The wealthiest and most powerful families in the world are assembled around the British monarchy. The monarchy itself is very rich, vastly rich, through stealing things. You know, that happened in the 19th and 20th century. But the power behind the monarchy, which can kill the monarchs and replace them, is an oligarchy of forces, including the opium traders of the 19th century into China, that sort of crowd. And they decided that the time had come to bring to an end scientific and technological progress as a general practice, to bring to an end the desire of the colonial countries, the former colonial countries, the so-called developing countries, for parity in development. They used sub-Saharan Africa as a test tube for genocide. And that is no exaggeration. They introduced among the youth of the 1960s and 1970s a dumbing down process. The students who graduated from universities after 1968 were less intelligent than those before, not for biological reasons, but for educational reasons and for cultural reasons. The students who graduated from high schools and universities in the 1980s in Europe and the United States are vastly inferior in every quality of, with a few exceptions, of course, almost, but vastly inferior generally to the graduates of high schools, secondary schools, and universities in the 1960s. As a result of these policies, which were called ecology or post-industrial society policies, not only was the development of the so-called third world halted, the developing sector was looted, denied the right to access to technology and looted at cheap prices. But that was the late 70s, late 60s. By 1970, if you measure productivity and consumption in terms of material consumption, plus education, plus health care, plus science and related services. If you measure that in terms of per capita for labor force, per household and per square kilometer, the planet as a whole has been devolving economically over the past 25 years. That is, the productive powers of labor as measured in actual products and services as opposed to prices have been declining. The United States is decaying. The United States, by the early 1980s, could no longer have launched the Apollo landing, the moon landing. We couldn't have done it. We had shut down whole categories of industry and put out of business whole categories of technology which were essential to the successful moon landing by the 1980s. Today, we're in far worse shape. All throughout the world, essential industries are collapsed and destroyed. And the per capita consumption, in real terms, is far less per capita, per household, and per square kilometer. Our infrastructure, our rail systems, our water systems, our sanitation systems have been decaying without repair. Our municipalities are becoming hellholes. This is obvious to us in the United States. It's also true in other parts of the world. We have reached the limit of the ability to control resistant strains of infectious disease by means of antibiotics and means of immunization. And yet we have halted medical research. What is being done to the physician in the United States is criminal. The physician in the United States, as a result of changes introduced in the past, about 15, 17 years, is no longer legally permitted to follow his conscience in the treatment of his patients. This has been taken over by the malpractice rules, by the insurance companies, and so forth and so on. The quality of health care available to the population today is, by and large, vastly inferior to that available earlier, largely because government and other busybody agencies and malpractice practices have stripped away from the physician's right to practice medicine. Since the percentage of the population which is actually producing wealth has shrunken to below 20% of the labor force, as compared to 60% of the labor force at the end of World War II, fewer people are actually producing wealth. More people are simply parasites engaged in occupations which make no contribution to the well-being of society, such as the New York derivative speculators. Who needs them? Such as these people playing with computers and chaos theory to speculate and loot pension funds, to loot school budgets with their privatization programs, to take over corporations and hostile acquisitions, and to destroy the valuable corporations which are our industries in order to loot profits to retire the debt which is incurred by the hostile takeover. The condition of most of the developing world is unspeakable. We have epidemics which are building up. We faced a global biological holocaust potentially analogous to that which brought the population of Europe in the middle of the 14th century down to half of what the population of Europe had been in the middle of the 13th century. Famine and disease are destroying the populations of the world. What is happening in Africa through famine, disease, and the activities of the World Wildlife Fund and associated agencies is a crime far worse than was made notorious in Eastern Europe under Hitler. And it's ongoing. We have faced a situation in Africa in which entire nations are about to be eliminated from the political map by the biological consequences of the policies which have been practiced in particular over the past 25 years, 30 years. That's the condition of humanity. In the early 1970s, another step was taken, beginning with the collapse of the U.S. dollar in the spring and summer of 1971. when some swindlers advised President Nixon to do a very stupid thing. But it wasn't stupid from their standpoint. And that is to destroy the last remnant of stability, of parities, of currencies on the basis of a gold reserve basis, and to go to what is called a floating exchange rate monetary system. The result of the floating exchange rate monetary system was manifold, and this became worse and worse, especially over the 1972 period from the Azores Conference through measures taken in the U.S. Congress in 1982 under George Bush's leadership in the Senate. What has happened is the creation of an unearned debt against the developing nations and other nations and to the advantage of speculators in the London market. How does it work? Under a floating exchange rate system, the currency of a country such as Brazil is arbitrarily, through market manipulation, is reduced way below its true value in purchasing power. Then the IMF and other agencies come in and tell the Brazilians, you must reduce the value of your currency. Otherwise, you will not be deemed creditworthy in international markets. But we say, okay, fine, that means we will pay you. You will give us higher prices for our goods than in our current currency because they're worth more on the world market. No. You will price your goods in your domestic market at the same price as before. You will simply have to give us more of those goods now to pay the debt, to meet the debt service. Well, we can't afford that. This process began with what London orchestrated with the help of Henry Kissinger is called the oil price hoax in the middle of the 1970s, in which the price of petroleum was rigged. Developing nations could not afford to continue to pay these jacked up prices, so they would borrow. The exchange value of their currency would be dropped. And purely bookkeeping loans would be made where the nations received no credit, in fact, whatsoever, but were purely charged. This is how the entirety of South and Central America has more than paid today, repaid the entire debt it had in the early 70s. And yet the remaining debt is higher by far than it was then. This is also true in Africa. It's true in Asia. And it's also true in developed countries such as the United States. Debt service created through a floating exchange rate system is eating away at real production. In point of fact, if you look at the U.S. economy and the European economies from a physical standpoint, that is in terms of market baskets of physical consumption, market baskets as a measure of productivity per capita. Actually, the economy of the United States, of North America, and of Western Europe is operating at a deficit, at a loss. That is, it is using up more goods to operate than it is producing. These countries are living only by looting one another, by looting old assets, or by looting what we call sometimes the Third World. In 1982 on, this floating exchange rate system began to generate a massive bubble, a speculative financial bubble of the same general characteristic as that bubble which caused the collapse of the European banking system in the middle of the 13th century. A bubble which is like the tulip bubble in the 17th century in Holland, or like the Mississippi bubble, or the South Sea Island bubble in England and France, the so-called John Law bubbles of the early 18th century. We now have a situation typified by the following. On the London financial market, or any other financial market generally in the world, say the London market, $1 trillion a day turnover approximately in financial turnover, of which less than 2% is accounted for in terms of commerce and trade. 98%, 97% are purely speculation, feeding the bubble. The politics of government, including the United States government, is to pay the debt to a Federal Reserve System, which is creating fictitious cash to feed these bubbles. So what is happening is that the real economy that produces the machine tools, the food, the clothing, the housing, and so forth, that economy is being shrunk by austerity measures which are aimed to provide more wealth to sustain the bubble. That is, a leverage, financial leverage against this stream of wealth is what is used to keep the bubble alive. The bubble is getting bigger. The economies are getting smaller. Since every economy is physically operating at a loss, everything taken out of the economy to pay the bubble is shrinking the economy. Now, it's like a situation of a man who has cancer, and the cancer is growing by eating him. And it gets to the point that the cancer is bigger than he is. And unless the cancer can continue to be fed at the same rate, the cancer is going to die. That is the situation of the world economy under the present circumstances. As a guarantee of that, what we face now is an imminent collapse of the global monetary and financial system. That collapse will come soon. If we talk about within 2 years, that's highly probable, that this system will end within 2 years, about the time of the next general election in the United States. It could collapse almost any morning. It could possibly be stretched slightly longer. That's a political question. But probably this thing is going to blow before the next general election, federal election in the United States, 1996. The system will collapse in any case. Nothing can save the present global financial and monetary system. It cannot be saved. It has no assets. It is already bankrupt. We can do nothing to save it. No matter how hard you tried, you couldn't save it. If you try to save it, you're just like the man who's already bankrupt, who starts embezzling to try to keep his firm alive when he can no longer salvage it. He's already bankrupt. He's just going to make it worse if he doesn't admit it. And that's the situation we're in. Now, the intelligent, rational thing to do would be to have the governments, the sovereign governments, do their job, and to put the world's central banks, the banking systems, and the financial markets into bankruptcy reorganization under government supervision. That would prevent chaos, just the same way as any good bankruptcy proceeding with a bankrupt company, whether the company is saved or not, is a way of preventing or minimizing the social chaos and disruption which attends a bankruptcy. The worst thing that can happen is in a bankruptcy is to let it run on, which causes chaos. The bankruptcy is a means of stabilizing a bad situation. Government can prevent chaos and keep institutions from being swept away when government gets the guts to put the existing central banks, including the Federal Reserve System, which is bankrupt, and the International Monetary Fund and so forth and so on, put these institutions into formal bankruptcy reorganization under government supervision. That is necessary. If that is not done, then you will have another kind of collapse. You will have a collapse which takes the form of what might be called a chain reaction implosion caused by what's called reverse leverage, which takes the form that on one bright morning people go into the markets and the man on the street assumes that everything will be business as usual that week. 2 to 3 days later, the financial institutions of the world have virtually all disintegrated because a collapse occurs which has no bottom. So we'll have either bankruptcy, an orderly bankruptcy, or we will have chaos. And if chaos occurs without remedy, we could plunge the world into a new dark age. Generally, in the history of dynasties, each time a dynasty of a culture has collapsed, There has been a protracted period of decades or even a century or longer in which the people of that culture go into what's called the New Dark Age, as Western Europe at the collapse of the Roman Empire, or what happened in the 14th century when the banking system collapsed. And about half the people in Europe died during the 100 years bridging that period, and about 30% of the population of Europe died in that period, partly because of the bubonic plague, but the bubonic plague spread under conditions which were caused by the economic collapse. We can go into a new dark age which can last on this planet well into the next century if we allow chaos to take over. So the question which confronts us today is, how do we address this crisis? How do we bring ourselves to recognize the failure of this system, that we're at the end of a dynasty, that all the old tricks don't work anymore? The ride is finished. The ship is sinking. If you try to cling to the ship and save it, you'll only drown yourself. You've got to get a new ship. And that's going to be the politics of the coming period. What, in my view, we have to do is we have to build now a general economic recovery program for this planet. And that's what I wish to devote myself to, but let me just make a few more remarks on a couple of points before getting to them. Let's look at the principle, first of all, which underlay the success of the Golden Renaissance. I mentioned earlier that in ancient times, that 90 to 95% of the population was treated within every culture as virtually animals, peasant animals, mostly living in rural life. And what are peasants in the mind of the oligarch? The peasant is a person who's like a little animal. He goes out and he manures a rock and he grows crops. 95% of the population are peasants or similar people. They grow the food. They live in miserable conditions, but they provide the food upon which the small percent of the population with its labor is able to maintain a culture. So you have at the top a very small group, an oligarchy. You have under them people who help them administer society, military, bureaucrats, whatnot, lackeys. And under it you have 95% of the population are oppressed and bestialized. That is the good part of this civilization, that we have shown how to solve that problem. Let me just identify why is the Renaissance in Europe in the 14th century so important to us today? What happened then to produce, as the map shows, or the chart shows, what happened in 1440 AD which caused a rate of growth of the population, which had stagnated at several hundred million people, suddenly to take off with hyperbolic growth, the growth to extend through the development of Europe, despite all the troubles and tribulations which occurred there, that the benefits of this culture were admired and sought out and adopted, sometimes not successfully, but desired, by most of the part of this planet. Up until the middle and late part of the 1960s, every developing nation of this planet, no matter what its cultural origins, desired the right to access to the benefits of technological progress. And was being, for part of the time, said, yes, you have a right, but it's going to be a little slow on delivery. Or then later said, no. Then Prince Philip said, no, you black Africans are annoying my animals that I intend to hunt. So you're going to keep your population down. A Prince Philip who said he wished he could be reincarnated as a deadly virus so he could wipe out the excess people. And that's the policy of the Worldwide Fund for Nature and the Club of the Arts. But what happened in the 14th century, in the 15th century, that's so important? Well, the principle here is very simple. Very complicated, but very simple in conception. You find it, if you read about the beginning of this millennium, this era rather, I read the writings of a famous Hebrew scholar and also a banker by the name of Philo of Alexandria, Philo of Judea. And he wrote a series of papers, which includes one on the account of creation given by Moses. And Philo says correctly and very clearly that man is created in the image of God, as the first book of Moses on creation says, by virtue of the fact that man, unlike any beast, has an intellectual power which mirrors the intellectual power of God. That is not merely an intellectual power to contemplate, but it's the intellectual power to create new things and to create true new things, not merely as ideas, as conversations, as opinions, but to take these ideas, bring them to nature, subdue nature, and produce a beneficial, improved state of nature which never existed before. This is how man grew. If man were an animal without this intellectual power, the human population of this planet would never exceed several million people. Man has biologically, without this power, no more potential for growth of population than a baboon or a chimpanzee, approximately. And therefore, our condition of life and our population numbers would never have exceeded that, approximately, of one of the higher apes, but for this power. So we know that in every human being, in every part of this planet, we can prove historically that every human being has this remarkable power which no animal has, this creative power. And as Philo says, it is this creative power, so that the intellect of man attempts to imitate the intellect of God through creativity, to call things into existence physically, states of matter which never existed before, through this creative power. And this is what makes man special and sacred. Philo taught that, the Christians taught that, the early Christians, St. John, St. Paul. And St. Paul conducted an evangelization mission throughout the area of the slaves, the Roman Empire, and preached that all men, by virtue of being in the image of God, were equal before God. That you could no longer have categorically a division of society among rulers, lackeys, and slaves, because all men are equal. Therefore, the just condition of the behavior of man toward man is to look into the eyes of another person and recognize that behind those eyes lies this remarkable intellectual quality which makes that person in the image of God. Well, this was the Christian idea. It was the Augustinian Christian idea which took strong root in Western Europe. But until 1440, this idea had never been put into practice as a principle of statecraft, of government. The introduction of the idea of science and a nation state committed to scientific progress for the benefit of every person and every family was a new idea, the nation state. And it was that idea, the responsibility of the state. For example, look in the U.S. Constitution preamble. The most important part of the U.S. federal constitution is in the preamble. To secure these blessings for ourselves and our posterity, the general welfare clause. The function of the individual, our lives are short, maybe sometimes long for a child, but as you get older as we do, some of us, lives get shorter and shorter. The months spin past. And what's life about? It's for the contribution you make through family and society to posterity. This is sometimes, as I said, called the general welfare clause. This is not put everybody on welfare. This means that the well-being of society is our concern. The New Age would have everybody on welfare and then kill them by starving them to death. So this idea was put into effect with the idea of the nation state. As Kuza says, for example, that every nation has the right to share in the scientific discoveries of any other nation, free of charge. That's the principle of humanity. And that is what gave European civilization, Western European civilization, its great power. Ah, but it wasn't that simple. The people who represented that which the Renaissance attempted to overturn, the Venetian oligarchy, similar people who had run the old feudal imperialist type of society, objected to giving up their power. As we know, in every part of this planet, you'll find people who believe that we must perpetuate a system in which 90% or 80% or 60% of the people must be underdogs. The creation of an underclass. Who believe that their right to idleness, to enjoy luxury and idleness at the expense of poor people laboring in bestial or brutish toil is the natural way of things. This is the struggle within China. This is the struggle within India. This is the struggle throughout the world to realize a form of society in which every individual is appreciated as being equal in importance from the time of birth. And these forces that didn't want that fought, and they fought hard. And as a result of a long history, which is a story in itself, those forces which opposed the Renaissance, which wanted to eliminate the nation state as an institution, which wanted to create an imperial world government or something of the sort, these people have gained the greatest power, the financial power. And that's what our problem is today. So by our not freeing ourselves, as the American Revolution, for example, attempted to do and did with some partial success, for which it was much admired in former times, before it began to get British ways and became less admired, we failed to free mankind of the overlordship of an oligarchy which is typified by the Worldwide Fund for Nature and the Club of the Isles behind it today. That's what our crime is. And because of a conflict between that which was good, the impulse to develop mankind, an impulse which is reflected in my generation and our support for the idea of the development decades, that was the good. But on the other side, the other forces have proven politically more powerful, partly because the ordinary people do not know what is in their own interest. And the ordinary people, as in the recent election in the United States, in many cases went out and voted for an outright fascist. The senior citizen who voted for Newt Gingrich, unless he's very rich, is committing suicide. And so forth and so on. So our problem is that we do not have institutions which have effectively mobilized the average person to understand his own true interest. This problem becomes more difficult when we don't have real education in our schools. Because we have people on the street we can meet, we can look them in the eyes, and within they are good people, but they are so poorly educated, so poorly informed. They don't know anything. Their minds have not been developed, and they lack the ability to understand their problem. So those of us who do know have the responsibility to act for the benefit of those who do not, and for the benefit of the children, the grandchildren, and the other descendants of those alive today. The great life, and there are only a few of us, I suppose, who are really dedicated to that, most of us tend to get into a Sancho Panza condition at one time or another. We're so concerned with our own belly we can't govern ourselves. The higher passions cannot seize us and grip us and sustain us. But those who take pleasure in doing good will look back at the long thousands of years of history before us. They will look back to the great gift which was given to humanity by Western European Christian civilization in the form of the Renaissance and the new institutions which are created. Those of us who enjoy that will participate and try to continue that process and relive it in its proper form for today. Because that, to us, is the greatest pleasure. Because we all know, as an old geezer like me, 72, I'm not going to not be around for much longer, and I better get about my business and decide to get the thing done that needs to be done by me, because I don't have much time to waste. And therefore, my interest lies not in myself as such, but in what I do for mankind. And that is the way you reap the richest harvest in your own life. The thing of which your grandchildren can be proud may be the thing which is most vital to your self-interest and true pleasure today. And that's what makes a statesman. As de Gaulle said in his memoir, speaking of the condition in which he took over the leadership of France after the disaster of the Fourth Republic, when France was about to disintegrate in its own decadence. He said he found the French people sitting like calves in the meadow, chewing their cud, who mistook the real estate of France, its rivers and mountains and pastures and so forth, for French interest. And he said the true interest of France was to recognize France's responsibility for the maintenance and improvement of civilization at large, so that France could prove that it was a necessary nation for the sake of humanity. And if each of us can do that and find ourselves, those who can find that the thing that motivates us is a recognition of what our necessary duty is toward humanity in our lifetime. That is our true self-interest. The good that we do for others, since we have such short lives, turns out to be our truest self-interest. And our grandchildren and great-grandchildren will probably share that opinion. But, so it was this conception of mankind which inspired the Renaissance, the few who made the revolution, the good revolution. And it is though, given the condition of mankind, those of us who understand this problem will have to act as missionaries and take the responsibility of leadership to bring the poor people of this world into a force which can reestablish the kinds of great institutions which the Renaissance brought us, minus the oppressive oligarchy, such as the Prince Philip and the Club of the Isles on top. That's where we stand. Now, I've indicated what the financial prospects are for us now. And we can leave for the moment the chart. I just recommend the chart to your reflection occasionally to recognize what a wonderful gift was given to mankind by the Renaissance, which proved that mankind does not have to live like a beast, either in totality or otherwise. 95% of the people do not have to live in brutish toil so that a few can live in privilege. We've shown in the United States that 2% of the population or less with modern technology can, if allowed, feed an entire nation and part of the rest of the world besides. We have shown that with about 60% of the labor force employed in industry, we can have the highest rate of wealth per capita imaginable. That there is no problem with the aid of science and this approach which cannot be addressed. There is a solution waiting for every problem that confronts us out there if we are mobilized to muster our creativity to solve it. That is what we must save. And it is the oligarchy that prevents that, which is what we must. I've got a little light here flashing at me. Does that mean something? I think they're changing a tape or something. They was warned that this would happen to me.
You've been an owl.
What?
You've been an owl.
Okay, fine. Okay, now Charles and company in the back room on the screen, we have some things to show on the screen. We'll get to that right now. First of all, I want to introduce to you the way in which the development policies, which we will identify here, came into being. Some of you know the story. It's of rather historic significance. Some do not. But by identifying it, those who do know it will put up with the repetition because it establishes the common ground for understanding. Are we clear, Charles? Nodley?
Yeah, we're ready for the
video. Okay, good. Okay, now, I got seriously into politics. I backed into it. In 1974, I happened to see something I knew because I had been involved in my professional work in economics in combating Norbert Wiener, John von Neumann, and others. So I knew what the New Age was and how dangerous it was. I saw in 1964 some proposals, including the so-called Triple Revolution, which informed me that the most hideous and most evil movement which could be imagined was about to be unleashed upon the populations of North America and Western Europe as a mass recruiting project. What became known as the counterculture, the New Age, post-industrial society. So I didn't know what to do. I was only an individual. I was a management consultant, privately. I'd worked for corporations, management consulting firms, and I was largely working for my own, working with people I knew on projects. What could I do? So about 1966, I had the opportunity to teach. And I got into teaching. And I found myself getting into trouble because a good number of young people seemed to like what I was doing. And what are we going to do about this? Well, all I was trying to do was to try to intervene on the campuses, hoping that I could help rescue a few talented minds from the garbage that was about to be dumped on them, on those minds. So we began to fight on practical issues. I was concerned about poverty in the United States, how it was unnecessary, how it could be understood. Research projects were done by these students, university students, some graduate students. This woman here was a student at that time, social work, graduate work at Columbia, and among others, they did studies of the way the real estate system works in New York, how the tenants are looted here in New York City. And they came up with a conclusive case and learned a good deal in the process. Others did other things. We organized around the point, which I was committed to, of course, as a matter of course, being a World War II veteran, that the solution for the problems of the United States was that the United States must make a commitment to the technological development of the developing sector. This, even in the narrowest way, would be advantageous to the United States. Because, you know, if you have a company and you're manufacturing a product, you don't believe in killing your customers. As a matter of fact, you try to sell them products which will make them more prosperous, because then they'll buy more products. And that was the way we proposed it to the, we said the people of the developing nations, if they're given the opportunity through infrastructure and investments to develop their own economies, will become bigger customers. So how, isn't it very stupid to keep them poor? To keep your customers bankrupt is not a very good business practice. So we organized around that. Well, we got into a lot of trouble, but just to make short and get to this point. In April of 1975, I was invited to go to Iraq and spent several weeks there. The occasion of the visit was the Ba'ath Party has an, or did have at least, there was a anniversary of its formation every year in April. And I went there because I liked the opportunity of talking to the Iraqis, find out what they were up to, and talking also with many other Arabs and others who were there from every part of the Arab world, the Islamic world. They were all there. And we had some wonderful conversations, and I expressed my views. I told them that the Lebanon was about to be divided by civil war, which some fellows in London and Henry Kissinger were about to unleash. And they said, no, that can't happen. We got the situation under control. I said, you don't know London and Henry Kissinger. And while we were there in Iraq, if some of you are old enough to remember that, the civil war in Lebanon broke out, with orchestrated from London, with weapons supplied in part by Henry Kissinger through the State Department. That sort of thing. So they became very interested in what I had to say in that circumstance. And we began to talk about some things. And I expressed my ideas on a number of subjects, including Arab-Palestinian peace, Arab-Israeli peace. And stated that the only possible basis for peace in a situation such as that between the Israelis and the Palestinians is to find a common interest. And the common interest, the only common interest which existed in that circumstance, considering the bloody bitterness which had erupted, it's like the Northern Ireland situation and other situations around the world, is a common, vital common interest in economic development of the region to mutual benefit. That if people can share, as separate sovereign peoples, the idea of cooperation to mutual benefit, including economic development, to improve the life of their people, that common interest can be the mortar which puts the bricks together and makes peace possible. Doesn't guarantee it, but it makes it possible. So the Arabs said, well, if you can pull it off and get these guys together, we're all for it. So when I left Baghdad, I got to Switzerland, presumably on the way home, and I decided to make a detour into Germany to get some jobs done in Europe. So I went to my friends in Germany, and we organized around that, and we had a big mobilization, including a couple of press conferences I gave. My wife was involved in this at the time. And we mobilized two things, a general international economic development program to counter the effects of the Rambouillet type of process of that kind of Azores conference, and also special efforts with both Israelis, who we found the same Israelis, and our friends in the PLO, to see if we could put this together and get some negotiations between Israelis and Palestinians going again on this idea of economic development. Because economic development then as now, in the context of Middle East peace now, is vital to the peace of the world. The Middle East is not merely an area of conflict between Israelis and Arabs, or among Arabs and Arabs. It is the crossroads of civilization. It is where the Mediterranean, which is the heart of Europe, meets the Indian Ocean, which is the gateway to the Indian and Pacific Ocean basins. It's the gateway to India, to Pakistan, to Southeast Asia, to China. The greatest concentration of population in the world, including the population of West Africa or East Africa. This is the future of civilization. Where the most people are, that's where the most development can occur. And therefore, it's important that we have peace in the Middle East and that we have nations in the Middle East which will administer as their business the things we need to establish better communications between the Mediterranean and the Atlantic and the Indian Ocean and the Pacific Basin, where the great population concentrations of this planet are located. We saw that then, and it's clearer, of course, now, when there has been a serious effort. And some of the same forces, the forces around Arafat, the forces in Israel which were associated with Shimon Peres and Rabin now, these were the forces we talked to in 1975. 1976, we were very close to pulling something off. It was very difficult. Not we, but we as a catalytic agent. Then the Likud government came to power and it collapsed. In the 1980s, there were efforts to do the same thing. Now, we came in 77. I became aware that what was called mutual and assured destruction, the so-called Kissinger-McNamara policy, really the Bertrand Russell policy, was actually the road to potential thermonuclear destruction of this planet. During that period, it was obvious to me that the weapon systems we're having in Russia and in the United States were more accurate, were forward-based, and that with the development of techniques such as enhanced radiation effects, the so-called EMP effect, the electromagnetic pulse effect, that a few thermonuclear warheads exploded over the United States could prevent the missile system, land-based missile system of the United States from functioning. And that a Soviet submarine, a boomer, or two, situated off the Atlantic and Pacific coast of the United States, could launch a dozen or half dozen warheads by missiles over the United States, and the United States was out of business, which gave the President of the United States a matter of a few minutes at most to decide whether to push the button. That the forward basing of NATO weapons toward the Soviet Union, including the submarine-based weapons, created a similar situation on the other side. And what Kissinger and McNamara hailed as the balance of terror as a key to peace was actually becoming a hair trigger for the potential of first strike. And technologically, the possibility of the first strike occurred. So I had tried to apply to this situation the same thing we had been applying with the many situations, including the Arab-Palestinian peace question. This was a featured part of my presidential Democratic Party campaign for president in 1979-1980. I met Ronald Reagan during that period. We had a little chat there, which caused a lot of people to become paranoid, but that's all right. Good for them. Paranoid people should have a right to exercise their insanity occasionally. But the time came when, for various reasons, people in the Reagan government asked me if I would be willing to set up a back-channel exploratory discussion with the top level of the Soviet government. We discussed it, and I asked them, I said, well, how about if we want to do an exploratory discussion, why don't I present to the Soviet government the proposal which I made as part of my campaign and see how they react to it as a way of getting a good discussion going. And it was approved. So on what I did is in February of 1982, after the agreement was reached to go ahead with this, I organized a conference in Washington, which was actually 2 days, on the subject of strategic ballistic missile defense and related problems. Most of the establishment in Washington, which is relevant, the intelligence establishment, was represented, as were most of the European governments and the Soviet and East Bloc governments. So I put the thing on the table, and then following that, I met with a Soviet representative in Washington by the name of Evgeny Shosnev, who is now retired, and we began discussions, where he was reporting to his government what the discussion was, and I was reporting to mine. In the meantime, I was presenting this as an option for discussion. There was great interest until Andropov was appointed in the summer of 1982 to replace Brezhnev, who was dying. In February of 1983, I got a flat turn down on the discussion from the Soviet government, from Andropov, through Shosnev. The point was they agreed that what I proposed was scientifically sound and militarily sound. But they said the United States would beat the Soviets in a crash program to develop these kinds of systems. Well, despite the turndown, the president went ahead with it, and it became known as the Strategic Defense Initiative afterward. Now, in my discussion with Shosnev, and what I told him he should relay to his principals in Moscow at that February meeting, was that if the Soviets attempted, if the President of the United States were to adopt my proposal, as he did publicly in the end of March that year in the famous television broadcast, that if the Soviet government were to reject that and to follow an independent course along the present track that it was already following, then I said, your economy, the Soviet system economy, will collapse within about 5 years. Your best chance, and the best chance for peace, is not to look for affection and love between the superpowers, but to find a basis in mutual interest, particularly the dangerous threat of we're both being driven to first strike by this silly system which Russell dreamed up and which Kissinger and McNamara are noted for. You bought it, it was a mistake. The United States government bought it, was a mistake. We've got to end it. It's dangerous. So these were my policies. Then in 1989, something happened. Let's show the video. I made an address as a part of my presidential nominating campaign for the Democratic nomination in 1982. I made it, for reasons which are obvious from what you'll see, in Berlin at the Kempinski Bristol Hotel. And this is an excerpt of that address. Come with me to Berlin, where I delivered a major press conference on the morning of Wednesday, October the 12th.
Under the proper conditions, many today will agree that the time has come for early steps toward the reunification of Germany, with the obvious prospect that Berlin might resume its role as the nation's capital. For the United States, as for Germans and Europe generally, the question is, will this reunification process be brought about by assimilating the Federal Republic into the East Bloc's economy or economic range of influence? Or can it be accomplished in a different way? In other words, is a united Germany to come into being as a part of Europe from the Atlantic to the Urals, as President de Gaulle proposed, or, as Mr. Gorbachev has desired, a Europe from the Urals to the Atlantic. I see the possibility that the process of unification could occur precisely as de Gaulle proposed. I base this possibility on the reality of a terrible worldwide food crisis which has erupted during the past several months and which will dominate the world's politics in every part of the world for at least 2 years to come. The economy of the Soviet bloc itself is a terrible and worsening failure. In Western European culture, we have demonstrated that the successes of nations of big industries depends upon the technologically progressive independent farmer and what is called here in Germany the Mittelstand. Soviet culture in its present form is not capable of applying this lesson. Despite all attempts at structural reform, and despite any amount of credit supplied by the foolish West, the Soviet bloc economy as a whole has reached the critical point. At its present time, in its present form, it will continue to slide downhill from here on, even if the present worldwide food crisis had not come into being. I do not foresee the possibility of genuine peace between the United States and Soviet Union earlier than 30 to 40 years from now. The best we can do in the meantime, in the name of peace, is to avoid a new general war among the major powers. This war avoidance must be based partly upon armed strength and our political will. It must be based also on rebuilding the strength of our economies. At the same time that we discourage Moscow from dangerous military and similar adventures, we must heed the lesson taught to us by a great military scientist from about 400 years ago, Niccolo Machiavelli. We must always provide our adversary with a safe route of escape. We must rebuild our economies to the level at which we can provide the nations of the Soviet bloc an escape from the terrible and worsening effects of their economic suffering. During 1988, the world will have produced between 1.4 and 1.7 billion tons of food, of grains, and that is already a disastrous world shortage of grain. To ensure conditions of political and strategic stability, during 1989 and 1990, we shall require between 2.4 and 2.5 billion tons of grain worldwide approximately. At those levels, we will be able to meet minimal Soviet requirements. Without something approaching that level, we could not.
Okay. Now, what happened, of course, after that address, which was, this was an excerpt of the address which was broadcast on a nationwide broadcast during the campaign that October, was that, as we subsequently discovered, the Soviet forces were mobilized in East Germany in 1989 to overrun Western Europe. That is, until the wall actually fell in the late 1989, Moscow was prepared for a military launch of overrun of Western Europe, including the British, which probably would have been fair to them, but I didn't want the rest of the people to suffer. At the same time, of course, the wall did fall. And it fell for exactly the reason that I told Yevgeny Shevchenko in 1983, and for the reasons I indicated in that address in Berlin and elsewhere, similar things elsewhere. So my response to the fall of the wall, particularly in discussions with my wife, who did a great deal of the work on this, and will tell you something about that from her first eyewitness experience. She shook the world up a little bit on this one. She can do that. Don't let her deceive you. She can do that. She shakes me up occasionally. Was to propose what became known as, in English as the productive triangle proposal, or in Germany, the productive dreieck proposal. You can show that slide, I think, Charles. This is just the cover of it. Gives an idea, get this thing started here. This is the document which was later published, which contained, it's a fairly thick document, which contained the plans for a general economic development of Eurasia, starting from an area in Europe which I called the productive triangle. Now this, if we go to the next map, Now if you look at, on here it doesn't show, but I wanted to get, first of all, a physical geographic image of this thing. There is an area from Paris which runs down to Vienna, which runs across Bohemia into Berlin. From Berlin it runs back above the Ruhr and above Lille in France to Paris. This area of Europe is the most highly developed area of the world. It has the greatest productive potential in terms of infrastructure of the world. It has inland waterways, which were started by Charlemagne on a large scale. We just completed in 1990, I believe, we completed the last leg of the Rhine-Main-Danube Canal, which was projected by Charlemagne in that period, 1,200 years or nearly 1,200 years earlier. It has the highest concentration of rail transport per square kilometer. It has the greatest volume of ton-mile hours of distribution of freight. It has the highest concentration of productive power potential of any part of the world. Therefore, my proposal was develop the productive triangle and run from the productive triangle. I think we can go to the political map, the next one. Or the political one. Oh, yeah. All right. Run the triangle from Berlin, from Vienna, from Paris, and run it in what are like the stellar spiral arms of a spiral galaxy. These spiral arms will include high-speed modern rail, preferentially magnetic levitation rail, including through the development of better superconductors, heavy freight carriage by this high-speed substitute for rail, magnetic levitation. This means 300 miles an hour. This means the virtual elimination of air transport, air traffic congestion for passenger flights, because you can travel 300 miles an hour along the route from Boston, Massachusetts, down to beyond Washington and Richmond. Who's going to take a plane? You can get there cheaper and safer and quicker by rail or magnetic levitation than you can by air. So develop that system. In the same thing, put our inland waterways. Western Europe is rich in standard inland waterways. Barge traffic is the cheapest method of inland freight, especially for bulk freight, for agricultural commodities, for heavy ore, sand, whatever. There is almost no development. There's some big things in Russia, but no general development in Eastern Europe of an adequate system of inland waterways to enable us to have low-cost bulk freight. There's almost no rail system capable of handling the needs of a modern economy. Western Europe, the triangle, has a great concentration of productive power, energies, including in France, nuclear energy, and some in Germany. If you want to put up an industry, that's the ideal place in the world to put it, or was at that time. You've got the labor, you've got the power, you've got the transportation, rail transport, cheap truck transport, very efficient, very costly, much more costly than rail, but efficient on short haul. And barge transport, power, sanitation, labor force, educational facilities, so forth. The best place in the world to invest. Begin to develop the areas down through the Balkans, by way of Italy into North Africa. Go to Warsaw from Berlin. From Warsaw, go to St. Petersburg. From the same area, go to Moscow. Go down to the Ukraine, to Kiev, and so forth and so on. And move further. Build across Asia. Well, this is not a new fantasy. This was actually proposed in a general way in the 1890s by a Russian, Count Sergei Vita, who was the foreign minister and government leader at times in Russia, who was politically a follower of the great Russian ally of Abraham Lincoln, Alexander II, who was a collaborator of Dmitry Mendeleev, the discoverer of the periodic table, the great chemist who also built the railroads of Russia, such as they were, and did some other things. Vinovsky is one of his students. And then France, you had Leo XIII, the Pope, had a French politician who was better than the average French politician. I have a lot of complaints about him. But his name was Gabriel Anatol. And Gabriel Anatol and Vita shaped a policy to build a network of rail and other infrastructure developments across from Brest in France to Vladivostok and into Japan by rail, modern rail systems, to take these rail systems down into China, to build a rail network from Berlin into Baghdad, and so forth and so on. This was the cause of World War I, because the British didn't want this to happen. The point was, we've had hell in Europe since that time, since the beginning of this century. 1989, the wall dropped, the division of Europe, the amputation of Europe from itself by the wall, by the communist divide, had ended, or at least partly. This was the great opportunity to take this vastly underdeveloped part of this planet, of Eurasia, from Berlin to the east, into Japan, down into China, linked to India, and turn Asia, which is the greatest concentration of the world's population, into a workshop of great productivity. And obviously, where you have the most people, you can get the greatest benefit from improvement in productivity, as in China or India. So that was my proposal, with my knowledge of modern technology. The assumption is we could bring these nations, which had gone through a great trauma, you know, it's like a death of the family when even a communist regime falls. The people are living in shock. They're living in a sense of freedom. It is necessary to act then in some way to bring a sense of stability under these conditions of shock. And if you can stretch the hand of friendship and cooperation to those people at that time, you may be able to bring about a great good, which would not be possible to win them to under other circumstances. That was our objective. Unfortunately, the British had other ideas. Now, let me just indicate what the problem has been and what the problem is today in politics. In November of 1989, directly contrary to what I was proposing, Mrs. Margaret Thatcher, who is a fascist, she is a protege of the Mont Pelerin Society, has the ideas of the Mont Pelerin Society, the ideas which came out of that brand of fascism, which is associated with Friedrich von Hayek, and those types of people. The type of fascism which is advocated by Phil Gramm, the senator in the United States, and in a sense by Newt Gingrich, the same thing. I know these people very well. As a matter of fact, they've got an Auschwitz program for privatization of the prison system. So they really do match up with the Nazis on these kinds of things. She began to scream, together with the same Conor Cruise O'Brien, who was her lackey at the point, who just caused the fall of the Irish government in an effort by the British Intelligence Service to prevent the Northern Ireland peace from functioning. They began screaming and said the unification of Germany would constitute an economic threat to the vital interests of Great Britain. It would be a Fourth Reich. It would link up with Russia. It would open up Eurasia. And they didn't say it, but they meant it. They represent the same threat that Anatol and Vita represented in the 1890s. What the British have done so far, and during the previous administration with George Bush in full cooperation, is to repeat exactly the same policy which the British used to create World War I. And I do not exaggerate. People will tell you something else in the history book, but they don't know what they're talking about. Here's how it happened. By 1896, Anatole and Vita had cemented a number of nested agreements which would have established these projects, this Eurasian economic cooperation, to help free China from the grip of the British through aid of economic development, to bring in the cooperation of the Japanese. At that time, prior to 1901 and the assassination of McKinley, the United States had been, since the time of Lincoln, had been allied with three major powers outside the United States. Germany, Prussia, Germany. Two, Russia, since the time of Alexander II. Three, Meiji Restoration, Japan. With the assassination of McKinley and a British agent, Teddy Roosevelt, brought into power, that switch shifted. Russia, Japan, and Germany, the United States' close relations with those countries was broken, and the United States established a close relationship with Britain. But something else happened in the meantime. In Africa, the policy of England at the time was to run a railroad as a method of conquest from Cairo to Cape Town. The area which was at risk in this was what we call today Sudan. The French policy in that period was to run a railroad, and had been from the 1870s on, from Dakar, is what we call today Senegal, to Djibouti in East Africa, a sub-Sahel rail line, which would run through the areas we call Nigeria, the part of Nigeria, Chad, and so forth, across Sudan, and across what we call Ethiopia or Abyssinia to Djibouti. The British were ready to go to war. This is 1898. The British were ready to go to war with France on this issue. Lord Kitchener, along with the grandfather of Boutros Boutros-Ghali, who was called Boutros Pasha Boutros-Ghali, who was a great assassin of Sudanese people in that time, and I guess the present UN General Secretary maintains that tradition as a British lackey who likes to assassinate Africans. That Kitchener moved down. Lord Grey from London controlled a French politician by the name of Théophile Delcassé and the so-called revanchiste faction in France. Delcassé cut an order ordering a French captain who was in the area, Captain Marchand, to surrender to Kitchener. And the policy of France was changed so that France became the lackey of England from that point on in an arrangement which became known as the Entente Cordiale, a relationship between a sodomite and a catamite. From that point on, the Entente Cordiale was consolidated in 1904. In 1905, the British began organizing the Russian Revolution, or they had already organized it, but they called it to bring down Vita. And Vita's power in Russia was destroyed by the 1905 revolution, just as a lot of Russian industry was destroyed, and the Baku oil fields. At the same time that the British, through the Dreyfus scandal and through the Delcassé Fashoda incident in Sudan, where Marchand surrendered to Kitchener, made France a captive of London. Then the British had a lodge in, the British owned the Serbians. The Serbians of that period were complete puppets of the British as they are today. This is not something new, this is an old story. The British had a Freemasonic lodge in Saloniki. This Freemasonic lodge was called International B'nai B'rith. The International B'nai B'rith Lodge in Saloniki became a government of Turkey called the Young Turk Government. Vladimir Jabotinsky, the founder of the Israeli Likud, was the editor of the newspaper of the Young Turk Government. On this basis, they induced Bulgaria to find itself at war with Greece. And with the aid of Serbia, set into motion a series of Balkan wars, which ultimately became World War I. In the process of this, with Vita out of power, the British managed to manipulate their assets in Russia to activate a Slavophil faction to move in support of Britain's puppet Serbia against the Croatians, Slovenians, Bosnians, and so forth, as they did today. Out of this arrangement, the British organized what became known as the Triple Entente. World War I began when the Russian army was called up in a general mobilization for the purpose of launching a military attack on Austro-Hungary and Germany. The Germans attempted to get the Russians to call off the mobilization because the mobilization would require them to mobilize. The Russians refused to call off the mobilization, the Germans mobilized, and World War I was on. What Mrs. Thatcher and George Bush did was the same thing. Mrs. Thatcher organized with Mitterrand and other forces in France a revival, as the British press and the British government said, of the Entente Cordiale. The same faction of British intelligence today says openly, the same faction is out to kill President Clinton, and that's a fact, that they are organizing a triple entente with Moscow against Germany in the lesser part, but primarily against the United States. What they have done, instead of opening up Eastern Europe, Russia, Ukraine, and so forth, to development, as we should have done, which would have led to the greatest economic boom on this planet, in this planet's history, we've done it. What they did is they imposed so-called reform through a virtual British shared puppet, Gorbachev, and his successor, who has the same politics, Boris Yeltsin. As a result of these reforms in Poland, in Czechia, in Hungary, Romania, and so forth, and Ukraine, the level of per capita, per square kilometer, and per household production of wealth in the former Soviet bloc is now today less than 30% of what it was in 1989. What you have in these countries are former Ambassador Bob Strauss's friends, a mafia composed of elements of the old state apparatus, which is stealing the country blind from the inside in Russia and hawking the proceeds for nickels, like people who steal television sets out of your apartment, on the streets of London for pennies. That Russia is being bled dry. Poland is being looted dry. The Czech economy, which is the so-called glorious example of reform, is in dangerous trouble. Hungary is suffering. The British, in order to prevent development, in 1991, launched their Serbian fascist puppets, and Milosevic is owned by the British Psychological Warfare Division, against, first of all, against Croatia and Slovenia. Then against Bosnia-Herzegovina, with the intention to broaden the war generally. The United Nations, through the Entente Cordiale, Franco-British, and a British agent as UN General Secretary, and a Yeltsin who is playing ball with the British up to a point, he may be overthrown any minute, who knows. He's not long for this world. Have orchestrated a bloody war and have run the war as a war against the present government of the United States. Not a shooting war against us, but every Bosnian shot is really a bullet aimed at the policy of the United States government. If this continues in Eastern Europe, you can imagine, the Russians have not been conquered by anyone since they escaped the Mongol occupation in the course of the 14th century, 15th century, we're out of it. They have not been conquered. They are not a people like some of the other nations of Europe who are used to being defeated and occupied for a time by other powers. They have a distinct culture with distinct problems, and they cannot accept it. These idiots in London and in Washington and elsewhere are driving the Russian people and the Russian military and other forces into a state of desperation which can lead to an explosion. They are committing crimes in the Balkans with the endorsement and backing of the British government and the French government and the United Nations, which are crimes as bad as those committed in the field by any stretch of the imagination by the Nazis in World War II. What they are doing in Africa is worse, but that doesn't make the headline. What they're doing in other parts of the world is simple. And so that's our problem. We can fix it still. If we can have the hand of friendship and economic cooperation reached out to these troubled areas of the world, we'll say, look, we're all in trouble, terrible mistakes have been made, let's fix it. And we can have peace, and that's what I'm at. And I believe in the principles which I tried with the Arab-Israeli peace, which are very important to me, that Mr. Peres and Mr. Rabin and Arafat pulled off as well as they did. Because that is a touchstone of an example of what can be done in the way of building peace between peoples who are separated by rivers of blood. And if you can build peace between people who are separated by rivers of blood, you can build peace anywhere through economic cooperation, related cooperation, to solve hunger, to solve the problems of the individual, of the family, household, and so forth. Okay, we have the political map of Europe. We've gone through this. Now, and you know the ninth forecast. I guess we don't have the cover of this. This is not it, but there is a pamphlet back there in which I indicate what I've described before, the nature of the impending global financial and monetary collapse. So the question is, given these facts, what do we do? And one would hope that we could induce some people around Washington and elsewhere, including to support the President of the United States, or this one back here, it's the ninth
There's
forecast.
Plenty on the table.
There's plenty on the table, so don't worry about that. To push such a policy now, forget the fact that this system is going to blow. My policy in every part of the world, which our friends, when governments ask us what should we do, or other people ask us what should we do, I said start the infrastructure building projects now. Start them on a small scale, because you have to start them, large projects on a small scale, to bring together the cadres of people who are going to do the job, and then you can expand the project on a larger scale once you've got a nucleus which is functioning and is proven, a proven administration and initial core. They should be done in all parts of the world. Water systems. In Africa, for example, fresh well water, potable well water is a crucial factor. You can always do something good in every part of the world if you just put your mind to it. Get these projects going, especially large railway, pipeline, power line, infrastructural building corridors. The way we finance this is simple. When we go into a bankruptcy, as we will, either through chaos or through orderly bankruptcy, it is obvious that anybody who's talking about free trade has to be a lunatic living in virtual reality. Because when the central financial and monetary systems of the world are in bankruptcy organization, there is no large source of private capital for large-scale investments. In a bankruptcy organization, you're lucky to keep the doors open. You do not have abundant internal resources. There's only one way you can approach this effectively. And that is to replace the present world system of central banking, that is, central banks controlled by private interests, like the Federal Reserve System, which is a chartered by the federal government, but it's owned by private financial interests. They have a monopoly over our money and our credit, not the government. If you want to cure the problem of the burdens of taxes, put the Federal Reserve System back into bankruptcy, and you find out how wonderfully the problem can begin to be solved. We'd solve it the way that George Washington and Alexander Hamilton solved the problem of a bankrupt United States in 1789-91. You go to Article 1 of the U.S. Constitution. The Congress of the United States has the authority under the Constitution, a monopoly on the creation of money. So what do? You can get the money you need, we'll need in the United States for projects, as I indicate, about $1 to $2 trillion. Just to get the United States moving in public works and related projects, to get it from going into a depression. You put the money into a depository called a national banking institution, which is connected to all the significant banks in the country. This institution loans this money to approved investments, such as by federal, state, and local public utilities. These public utilities can borrow at the preferred rate, and they get payment on the same basis that a building contractor gets progress payments for salaries and so forth, payroll and for materials as he goes along and does phases of the job. That way you're not putting a big chunk of money into circulation except as the work is done. So then you have contractors who go to work as bidders who win contracts to assist these agencies in building these projects. they too get credits the way we used to give credit out to war contracts. When you got a war contract, you could take it to a bank and you could discount that contract for lending and you could get the money to keep your project going. On that basis, by putting $2 trillion, for example, into circulation in the United States through work, not through throwing money out in the street, but through work, you then generate the basis for a general revival of the U.S. economy. And that is the only way that any part of the world is going to recover from the kind of crisis which we're going into now. There is no hope of getting out of this crisis until we get rid of central banking and replace it with the kind of national banking which the United States used in its first federal administration to get the United States out of bankruptcy to become one of the most prosperous, productive economies in the world. And that, of course, was used in Germany with Liszt, with the, and so forth. So that is the authority which the Congress has under Article 1, the authority which the President can invoke with the consent of Congress to provide the money as credit for through national banking to get essential projects going. And we have a need for massive rail, power, water projects, as well as cleaning up these cesspools which we call our cities in the United States today. Remember, an urban community is a piece of infrastructure. And if it's run down and destroyed, it's just like a railroad or a water system or a sanitation system broken down. You cannot have industry, you cannot have production without these kinds of things. So that's the method around the world. Now, on that basis, let me indicate what some of these projects are. The Eurasia Topographical. That's 1,100A. Okay. Well, this is Europe. That's all right. We'll start with here. We've got the Eurasia. No. That's the other series. Back. Going the wrong way. Should be an eraser. All right, fine. You got it. All right. Now, what we proposed originally, of course, was to go from the triangle in Europe across Eurasia. This has two features. Back in 1983-84, we did a proposal which is called the Indian Pacific Basin Development Program, which addressed the fact that the Pacific region with the Indian Ocean region, is literal, will become the center of the world economy in the coming century. That's where the population is concentrated. If you look at North America, South America, Central America, bounding on the east. You look at Africa, East Africa, bounding on the west. You consider the Antilles, Japan, Taiwan, and so forth, the Philippines, down into Southeast Asia, Indonesia, Malaysia, and so forth. The Indian subcontinent, China, well, you're talking about over 1.2 billion Chinese in that region. You're talking about a similar, or actually a larger quantity in South Asia. You include Pakistan, Bangladesh, India, and so forth in that region. You're talking about something going up toward 500 million people in Southeast Asia alone. You look at the population of the United States and Canada. Population of the nations which are on the Pacific coast of South America. You envisage a new sea level canal through the region of Panama, which brings the Atlantic into the Pacific much more efficiently than now. And you can see very quickly that with high-speed ships using new techniques, magneto-hydrodynamic drives, we now have a completely new picture of the world in which the maps no longer center around the Atlantic Ocean as they used to, but the maps of the world center about the Pacific Ocean and the Indian Ocean. So now Europe has access to this region through the Mediterranean, the canal, the Middle East. The object is to build a land bridge to and from Europe into China, into Japan, and into Southeast Asia, so that the littoral development, the coastal waterway system in Eurasia, in Asia in particular, is supplemented and integrated with a rail bridge situation. Now, there are three rail bridges from China into Europe. One goes north directly to intersect through Kazakhstan, presently, the Trans-Siberian artery. Another goes along a more southerly route through Iran and goes up into Turkey. A third route goes down to a link to an area where I served back during World War I into the area near Bamo from Kunming. And that link goes across to Dhaka in Bangladesh, goes across into Egypt, across that region. So there are three major rail arteries potentially from China into Europe and vice versa. This means that the entire area of Siberia, if we do some major engineering on fresh water, and there's plenty there, that's the center of water for Eurasia, is right there. If we do major engineering, then this whole area opens up seriously for development. And the development of trade, power, inland waterways, and so forth ensures that. We can proceed now to this other question, these other slides on the... All right, now, let me explain what I'm talking about. Obviously, this kind of planning has to be controlled in some way. You have to have some scorecard, some meters and measuring devices to determine what works and what doesn't work. Generally, I use, and it's my specialty, is called physical economy. In physical economy, we may use prices in a certain phase of our work, but we do not base our estimates of national performance on prices. We study the flow of price movements, but we do not base the estimate of the performance of the economy on prices. What we base it on is values of essential consumption in infrastructure, by producers, essentially, and by households of material consumption, the material consumption required to maintain a certain standard of living, which generally corresponds with a certain level of technological development, plus education, plus the health care, plus the science and related services. That is what people consume, that's what industries consume, that's what infrastructure consumes. Physical product plus these things. We measure the market basket per capita and per family of consumption. We measure the consumption industry per capita. We measure the productivity in these terms per capita in labor force. We measure that in terms of per capita for labor force, household, including accounting for household demography, and also per square kilometer. We measure things like ton-mile hours against relative physical cost for media of transportation, such as inland waterways, ocean freight, coastal freight, that sort of thing. And we measure also the water in terms of liters or cubic meters per capita, per hour, and so forth, for human consumption, for industry, and this, the water requirements of the society increase as the level of productivity increases. We measure not only the kilowatt hours of energy required for a level of technology and productivity, we must measure the what was called the energy flux density of that power. As you go to much higher technologies, you require better focused power at higher localized energy flux densities. Higher energy flux densities of the type you get with hydrogen fusion, for example, give you much higher, vastly higher efficiency throughout your entire system than you could get with a low temperature source of heat. So all these factors are taken into account. We will then figure out what the price is of a wage, and we will then trace the movement of price movement of trading and so forth through the economy, but we measure primarily in physical economy. Now, therefore, in measuring, we have two things to do. I won't go into the details here, but indicate the basic way in which you measure economy and physical economy is what I call a system of inequalities. What has to relatively increase, what has to relatively decrease. But you must scale it. So what I had to do years ago was to define an approximate scaling. Now, when it comes to scaling, if you want to build a ruler, you can pick an arbitrary measure. If it's a linear ruler, you can make your ruler up of anything, cubits, feet, whatever you want to make it up, centimeters, whatever, except it has to be consistent. Now you go out and measure things, and that's called scaling. What I needed was a standpoint of reference for scaling economies upon which this kind of long-range planning among different kinds of economies and different conditions could be correlated without subjecting them to these so-called misleading price calculations. So what I did is I took three economies which were industrialized and two which were underdeveloped. The three I chose which were industrialized were Japan, West Germany, and the United States. As my baseline, I used 1967 to 1969. The reason I chose those years is that the technology of the three economies was at the same level, approximately, the productivity about that time. Because after 1968, 69, the U.S. economy began going into the sewer bucket. And Europe began to decline more rapidly than Japan. So disparities developed after that. I then compared 1967, 68, 69 with 1980 figures. Against these three developing economies, which each have different population densities and therefore different infrastructural characteristics, I compared the two major developing economies, China and India. And therefore, by exploring the gap in development between India and China on the one side and these three industrialized countries on the other, I established an arbitrary ruler of arbitrary length to compare different economies around the world and to reference which one is improving and which one is going into the bucket, so to speak. So that's what these are. And just run through these slowly so people can see. You see the factors here we've listed just to give some indication that the world is not overpopulated. If you want to say the world is overpopulated, you should go first of all, I suppose, to Singapore or Hong Kong, but then you would go to Belgium. And Africa is vastly, by the way, underpopulated. Somebody tells you differently, they don't know what they're talking about. Matter of fact, there's vast agricultural land there if it were developed. If people had fresh water, if babies could live old enough to have babies, things like that. All right, so that's the situation. Let's take the next slide. Same thing. We compared each West Germany with Belgium. Then Japan. Next. All right, fine. Then you've got the next slide. Okay, China compared with Belgium. Obvious difference. You get copies of these things. Then the next on the case of India. So these are the kinds of measures we use. A set of inequalities plus, as a yardstick, a comparison with Belgium as a common unit of relevance comparison and comparing Japan, Germany, and the United States with China and India. Because in that you will find all the problems stated that you need to know in studying how things are going in the rest of the world. What we really need to know is for a level of technology and productivity, what standard of living do you have to provide for a household to sustain that productivity and so forth? What standard of living do you have to maintain a demographic model which will make the economy work? I mean, if you have an economy in which altitude is life expectancy by years, the baseline is the percentile of the population in that age interval. If you get in economies like very poor developing economies, it's very flat triangle. If you get what they're trying to do with China is make it like that, so you have almost no babies and a lot of old people. So the solution is to control your problems, you kill the old people, which is pretty much the idea that Newt Gingrich has for the United States these days. So these facts, the correlation of the level of infrastructure with technology, the productivity of labor, the conditions of life of the household. Oh, I'm getting a flashing one. We'll just get in. Okay. Would a change of the tape or what?
Yeah, that's what that is.
Okay. And I've got a red light.